Welcome everyone to Hens All Access for the first edition of Beyond the Arc. I'm Scott Klassen with head men's basketball coach Monté Ross. Coach, CAA champions going into this year, 2014, journey to the NCAA tournament. We've had some time now, and we will talk about this year, but let's first look back. I mean, the journey that you've taken with this program, when you first got here, the team was that you were handed was really in shambles, and you have really turned this turned this program around. 39-13 over the last 3 years in the CAA, the winningest record in the conference, and then last year, of course, winning the tournament, going to the NCAA tournament, and playing Michigan State. Reflect a little bit on the journey.
The neat thing about it is we had sustained some success over, like you said, the last 3 years, and I thought it was very important for the kids to win it. Not that if we didn't win it, it would have been a failure or anything like that, but I just thought it was very important for them to get over the mountaintop, because we had gotten so close the year before that, you know, losing the semifinals, the way that happened and all that kind of stuff, that I thought it was just such a great feeling. And the thing about a championship is it can never be taken away from you. No matter what happens, no matter, you know, what goes on, that team is bounded for life, along with the coaches. Mm-hmm. And the other thing it did, it allowed us to enter, which I'd never really thought of it like this, but a couple of the older alums from very successful teams that had gone to the NCAA tournament said, you know, Coach, you know, now you guys are in a very exclusive club.
Absolutely. And going into this season now, as we transition, you're able to max out the talent on that team. A lot of older guys on that team built to make that NCAA tournament mm-hmm. run. But unfortunately, when you turn the clock, a lot of guys are missing now from that squad. Four starters are gone. One returns, though, and that's Kyle Anderson. What will his experience mean to a younger group this year?
You know, his leadership is going to be tantamount, just because, you know, he understands every single drill that we call out. He's done it. He knows where to go. He knows where everybody belongs. These new guys, nine freshmen and sophomores, they just don't know. And even the sophomores, if you look at, you know, Barnett Harris, who played just a little bit sparingly last year, Kasman Hayes and Devon Pinkert, who played probably a little more than Barnett did in the long run, but never were really relied upon. So it's different now because we're relying on these guys. And again, nine freshmen and sophomores, it's practices have been up and down. They've been up and down. And I expected that. We want to get to the point, and I keep telling them, we have to get to the point where we are constantly consistent.
Let's talk about some of those other guys on the team beyond Kyle Anderson. And one of the things, one of the many things that your coaching staff and you have been able to do over the past several years is develop big men. When Jamel Hagans came in here, he was not recruited by a lot of teams. And you took him from that guy to a guy that left Delaware with the best stats of any big man in Delaware history and now getting looks at the NBA. Carl Baptiste was a guy that didn't play very much his junior year. And by the end of his senior year, he was the best center in the league. Now, when you look at this new crop of big men, who has some potential maybe down the line to be a very good big man in the league?
Start with our freshmen, Eric Carter and Sky Johnson. Those two have been probably a little better than I thought they would be at this point. I think their talent level is something that will shine through and show through in the long run. But they've been very, very good here of late. And then you move ahead to the sophomore class, which is Barnett and Mo Jeffers. And, you know, Barnett just gives you a certain type of energy every single time he steps out on the court. And Mo is still learning. He's a guy that hasn't played a lot of basketball in his life, in his lifetime. So he's still learning. So he's still gangly and all over the place. And we're trying to really get him. And the best thing for him is going to be that experience of being out on the court. That's what's going to really help him in terms of his development. And then Marvin King Davis. Marvin is a guy that played a lot last year, has played. And, you know, he's another guy who I consider an older guy who's going to have to really lead by example with these younger guys that we have.
And looking at the guard position, you went ahead and went down to Maryland, got yourself another guard. That's the guy, Corey Holden, that I've been hearing all about. For those who don't know, Devon Sadler was also from the Maryland area. And he seems to be the guy, as far as the freshman class, that might be ahead right now. But tell us a little bit about your guards that are coming in and some of the guys that played a little last year.
Corey Holden is probably a little bit advanced in terms of being a freshman. He's been a little banged up here lately. We got to get him healthy. But here's a chance. Here's a chance. He has a certain way about his style of play, a certain pace to his game that will allow him to be a pretty good player. And then Anthony Mosley, a local kid from Sanford, he has a college body. Defensively, he's really talented. And, you know, he has a chance to really make some hay in terms of disrupting what other teams want to do when they're on offense. And then, you know, I think the probably the most heralded guy coming in, and it's probably Shavarsky Corbett from Tampa, Florida. And Shavarsky's been banged up. We think we're going to get him back. We think, and we hope so, because he's, you know, again, it's going to be a little while because he's missed so much practice. He hasn't practiced with us at all. He had a little knee procedure done. And, you know, he's going to be down the line here this year. He has a chance to be really, really good. He's really, really talented and really special. So, you know, those are the guys that have come in. And then when you say the guys that are returning, obviously we know about Kyle and what he's capable of doing. And, you know, I'll say this about Kyle because I don't think it should be brushed over, is Kyle has averaged 21 wins a year since he stepped on campus. And, you know, all he knows is winning. So that's what he's preaching to all these other guys. And then Devon Pinkard and Kasman Hayes. I think those guys have had terrific, terrific off seasons this summer. And so far in the preseason, they've been very good, shooting the ball very well, shooting the ball with a lot of confidence. And we're going to need those guys to step up. And I think they'll be able to.
And finally, you mentioned Kyle Anderson with 21 wins per year. He's averaging. I think he might be the reason we call the show Beyond the Arc. I'll have to look into it.
I like it with
Jimmy. But he knows winning. The pedigree that you've brought to this Delaware program now and with that championship last year is you come to Delaware, you expect to win basketball games. Last year, the CAA poll picked your team fourth. Mm-hmm. That ended up with a championship. This year, picked a little further down. How will that pedigree, how will maybe some of that experience from Kyle and other guys knowing how to win help when you go through some bumps in the road this season?
Well, you know what? And we never really talked much about it last year when we picked fourth. We thought we were probably better than a fourth-place team. And we didn't talk about it this year. We picked eighth. I noticed you brushed over that. Didn't want to say that eighth spot. But, no, we don't mind. We picked eighth, and we think we're a little better than eighth. Mm-hmm. But it's all going to be decided on the court. And I think I don't blame where we are picked, because when you lose the talent and amount of points, someone told me we lost 75% of our scoring, something crazy like that.
That seems low.
Yeah, it's probably more than that. And, you know, when you've done something like that, the expectations have to be tempered just a little bit. But I just think, like you said, that these guys expect to win. And when you expect to win, there's certain things that you have to do. You have to practice a certain way. You have to act a certain way off the court. You have to do what you're supposed to do in the classroom. All things that our guys have always done here in this program. So we have to make sure that those guys, the new guys, understand what the expectations are. Again, not just the expectations on the court, but the expectations off the court, in the classroom, in the community. And we have to make sure that those guys are upholding all of those like all of our teams in the past have done.
All right, we are going to take our first time out. When we come back, we'll talk about a schedule, always tough non-conference schedule for the Delaware Blue Hens. We'll also talk about the CAA. Back in a moment on Beyond the Arc.
Hey fans, 12 and younger, do you want to be a future Blue Hen? Join the Future Hens Club presented by St. Francis Healthcare for invites to exclusive events and free admission to select UD games.
Meet coaches and players like us.
Get your official Future Hens t-shirt and more surprises.
To join, log on bluehens.com with a parent, click on Fan Zone, then Kids Club. Click Register Here, fill out your information, and click Submit.
Join today!
Welcome back to our season preview edition of Beyond the Arc. I'm Scott Klatskin with head coach Monté Ross. And coach, we talked about the team and now the schedule. You've done it again.
How about this bird? I really like this bird. This is fascinating what you guys have done.
It's a nice studio, and we're glad to be here at Jimmy Smith & Company with the studio for the first year. A nice addition.
Absolutely. I love it. The upgrades are amazing.
Absolutely. I agree. Thank you very much, UD. I just come in and do the show.
There you go.
And they supply me with this great studio to do the show from. But your schedule, every year, it seems we look at the schedule, and it's just so tough non-conference. This year, you've got, amongst other things, Temple at home. You've got a road trip to California. You're playing Stanford out of the Pac-12. You've got a game at Wells Fargo Center. What goes on? What's the thinking behind challenging yourselves every year in this non-conference slate?
Well, I think, for us, everything boils down to what you do in the CAA. And we have to make sure that we are well prepared once we get to the CAA, once we get to conference play come January. So we want our guys to go into different venues, tough venues, venues that will prepare them for when we have to go on the road to Drexel, to James Madison, when the band is, right there on top of you. And I don't want to be the type of team that can only win at home. I want to be the type of team that can go on the road and be able to win, because that shows a certain toughness about your group. That's the type of program that we've been able to build, a team that is able to go on the road and win in tough venues when everybody is against you and all you have is your teammates, your coaching staff. That's all you have to count on. And part of that has always been, let's go and play tough places, tough teams in the non-conference, so that when we do get to conference, that we're prepared. At Stanford, they'll be a top 25 team. Villanova will be a top 25. They'll probably be a top 10 team by the time that we play them. We have, Temple. They have some guys that were sitting out last year. And, I just think Fran Dunphy can coach the horns off of a bull. So he's just unbelievable. And, so we'll be challenged. And I like that. I like the fact that we'll be challenged. We just have to make sure that these guys, no matter what happens, good or bad, that they don't get too high, they don't get too low, that we stay even keel and are able to get on to whatever is next. Whatever the preparation is, whoever the opponent is, that we have to have that strength, that resiliency to get on to the next thing, whether it's after a loss or after a win.
It all starts on the 17th at Liberty, and then through the non-conference, eventually you land at that CAA slate that you talked about. And we mentioned where you guys are in the CAA preseason rankings. So who are some of those teams that are going to be a good competition this year in the conference?
I think Northeastern, although they only won 11 games last year, but they have more people back than anybody else in the league. So I think Northeastern is going to be a very good opponent this year. William & Mary, I think whenever you go out there and you have the player of the year, preseason player of the year, or the opportunity to have the best player on the court in Marcus Thornton, that gives you a chance every single night. I think Drexel will be good. I think, again, Damian Lee, he'll have a chance to be the best player on the court every single night. This is the year where a team that's not so much thought about or talked about can climb up into the top of the league. And the league is a little bit down than it was last year. Last year, you had to be, although we won it, you had to be one of the best teams in order to win it. You sort of knew it was going to be a core of, two, three, maybe four teams that could win it. But this year, I think it's much more wide open than that. And it'll be interesting. I think, we all went down to Baltimore last year, especially for us with the mission, having won the regular season. Okay, let's cap this thing off. But I think this year going down to Baltimore, it's going to be such a wide open affair. It's going to be very exciting.
Well, I'm looking forward to another fun year of Delaware men's basketball.
Thanks, man. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much, Monté. And we'll take another time out here on Beyond the Arc. When we come back, it'll be Matt Janis and Tina Martin talking about women's basketball here at Delaware.
Hello, Delaware fans. This is Coach Brock at beautiful Lums Pond State Park, just minutes from Delaware Stadium. I'm inviting you to come to the park, enjoy their year-round camping, boat rentals, equestrian center, and so much more. While you're here, experience the Go Ape Treetop Adventure. Go Ape is an outdoor experience where you can live life adventurously and experience the park from 50 feet up in the trees, hanging by a wire. To learn more about Go Ape or to book your visit to the course, visit www.goape.com. Go Hens!
Welcome back to Beyond the Arc, our season preview edition, joined now by the head coach of the women's basketball program at the University of Delaware, Tina Martin. I'm Matt Janis. Coach, you're coming off of yet another 20-win season, but what maybe made it more impressive than some in the past was how much production you had to replace a season ago. You lost over 6,000 points, 3,500 rebounds, 1,000 assists. You're probably sick of hearing that statistic. But we're still able to get to another CAA championship game, a remarkable accomplishment, your fourth consecutive as a program. Talk about what last year meant to your team and to your program to be able to reload as quickly as you did.
Well, I mean, we had a lot of question marks, no doubt, with all that loss of production. But it meant a lot because I think that it established us in the CAA again as a premier team. And obviously, Kelsey Buchanan had a breakout year as a senior and stepped up and played terrifically. And Akima Richards, our other senior, really played her role from a leadership standpoint. And some of the younger players got to show what they could do. And needless to say, we were nervous going into last year just because we were so young and so untested. And but the kids, as you said, they stepped up big time in another 20-win season and back to the finals again. So, you know, I was really proud of that group. But obviously this is a new year, and we're going to try to build on that. And another young group, I'll tell you, we've only got the two seniors again. So, you know, some untested players. But I think they're anxious to show what they can do as well. And we're just going to put our best foot forward.
You mentioned Kelsey Buchanan, who meant so much to your team on both ends of the floor. You lose her to graduation, but you do bring back a cast of characters with some good experience from what they were able to accrue last year, and certainly talented. Let's start with Courtney Green, who at times last year you had to beg to shoot the ball, but when she does put it up, she's awful dangerous. Do you expect her to take that next step this year after the experience she's been able to put forth?
You know, I do, and she really showed a lot this fall from the standpoint of she was taking over a leadership role and wanting the ball, and she's really improved her game. And then unfortunately she got hurt this fall, and she hurt her knee, and she's been out now for almost 3 weeks. And so we're waiting to hear, you know, what her status will be for our first game. And certainly we're hoping that she may be able to play in that first game. But I thought she had the best summer of anybody on our team. Actually, she and Hannah Jardine, I thought both those young ladies came back really ready and prepared to step up this year. And then she had the injury. So hopefully Courtney's going to be able to play in that first game, like I said, and bounce back from this knee injury.
You mentioned Hannah Jardine, who had an interesting debut as a freshman. Started out a little bit slow, which is to be expected when you're making your collegiate debut, but she just got better and better as the season went forth, and also more confident on the offensive end. You said that she showed some real promise in terms of taking that next step. What does that next step look like in your mind?
Well, I mean, more offensive-minded. You know, Hannah at times passed up shots last year, and it drove our coaching staff crazy because, you know, she was and earned one of the starting guard positions, and so we needed her to step up and shoot the ball. And as most freshmen are, I always say it takes a freshman at least 8 to 10 games to really get their feet wet and start to develop their game, if you will. And I thought Hannah started to look for her shot by the end of the year, and coming into this fall, she definitely has an offensive mindset and has scored double figures both of our exhibition games, and we need that from her. We need her, whether she's playing the big guard spot or the small forward spot, playing inside a little bit as well. We need her to look for the outside jumper, to post up a little bit, and just be more aggressive on the boards. That's what I need her to do to improve, and she's done that. And so, as I said, I think she's ready to step up and make a big contribution this year.
She definitely brings flexibility to your team. Flexibility also comes from having two point guards that have very different games, but certainly complement them very well. I mean, you have Jody Sawyer coming off the bench and Erica Brown, both freshmen, both playing the floor general spot, which is a lot to ask of young players. They handled it pretty well. What do you expect to see from the point guard spot this year? How do those minutes divvy up?
Well, you know, I want them on the floor a lot. Both Jody and Erica obviously can handle the ball, and they make good decisions. Erica has more of an offensive mindset where she wants to shoot it more, but thankfully, Jody went home this summer and really worked on her jump shot, and she's knocking down shots now and was in double figures as well in one of the scrimmages, which was really good to see. And, you know, I think both of them are going to get a lot more playing time than you'd think. There are going to be times when we play them together. And, you know, I think both of them can have an impact because of their ball handling, because of their court savvy. Jody's more of a setup point guard, and as I said, Erica's more of a driving, slashing, scoring type of point guard. So they both are back, and they're both ready to go. And again, I believe we'll play them both together at times, as well as even maybe even Courtney Green. So we might be a little smaller in the backcourt, but we certainly will be quick, and we will get up and down the floor, which is something that I really would like us to do.
In the front court, you have to replace Buchanan. Joy Caracciolo comes back. She gave you some big minutes last year when she was able to stay out of foul trouble. Is she ready to shoulder a little bit more of the front court scoring load?
Well, I sure hope so. I mean, she's a senior, and she needs to step up for this team. And, you know, she has the knack and the ability to use her body well and draw some fouls. We do have to keep her out of foul trouble, and she has to be able to finish inside. You know, at times she rushes, she gets too excited, and but she has the capability of being a double-figured type of scorer for us. And I expect Joy to really step up and be a leader for this group, this being her senior year. And, you know, and then Steph Leon is the other young lady that's a senior. And both of them have to play defense, and they have to have a scoring mentality. Steph's more of a defensive player, but Joy in particular needs to step up and score the ball when she gets those opportunities inside.
You have some young players coming in. Who of the newcomers can we expect to see play a role soon in this season?
Well, I think Makeda Nicholas is going to play a big role. Makeda is a young lady that you know, is playing the forward position for us, and she can run the floor, she can rebound, she can defend. You know, she's getting more apt at playing with her back to the basket. She needs to get a little bit more comfortable with that. But she makes a big presence known in the defensive end because she can block shots, and she's strong, and she can push people off the blocks. And as I said, she's one of our most athletic players. So Makeda will have a chance to make an immediate impact. Whether she starts or not remains to be seen. But she has that kind of capability, and she'll see a lot of minutes her first year here at Delaware.
Always room to improve for a young team, but a lot of talent coming in to this 2014-2015 season. We're going to take a break here on Beyond the Arc. We're joined by head coach Tina Martin. Her Blue Hens getting ready for the season to start this week. When we come back, we'll look at the non-conference schedule and also head to conference play here on BlueHens.com.
We are the champions. Throw your hands up, welcome to the other land of dreamers, brothers, sisters, others. Yeah, we all fight like that.
Rush hour or relax hour? It's your choice. Dark. Moving forward.
Welcome back to Beyond the Arc. We're with head coach Tina Martin. Her Delaware women set to begin their season on Friday. And coach, a non-conference slate, a bit more challenging than what we saw for your team a year ago. You have a little bit more experience, and it seems like some tough road trips ahead of your squad.
Yeah, we do. You know, we open up on the road, which is always tough because our freshmen have to be ready to be thrown into that fire. And, you know, I think Lafayette will be a tough test for us because we are on the road. They are a 500 team. They've got four of their five starters back. And but we're excited. We're excited for the season to open. You get tired of practice sometimes of playing against each other, and you really want to take on that competition. And then we're playing Marist College on Sunday, the home opener. And they were only 27-7 last year, won their conference championship and went to the NCAA tournament and played Iowa in the first round. So nothing like jumping into the fire, so to speak, right away with an NCAA team. And, you know, and then we've got Fordham also coming in later on in the season. They're the A-10 champion. They had a great year, obviously, went to the NCAA tournament. And we're going to Cincinnati's tournament and playing some stiff competition there as well. And, of course, Princeton, which has a chance to win the Ivy League championship again. They were an NIT team. So, and East Carolina on the road is another NIT team that won 23 games. They were 23-10. So, I mean, yeah, we've got a tough non-conference schedule, but I think it will prepare us for the CAA, which is obviously our goal. And our conference as a whole is going to be really tough. And I think overall, you know, the kids have to be ready to take on that kind of stiff competition once we get to CAA play.
It is our season preview. preview, and we're talking about the non-conference slate, which is challenging for your team. But let's also look ahead at the CAA. Granted, you won't start playing the conference until January, but at the end of the day, that's what you're trying to win. You came in second a year ago, both regular season and postseason, another CAA championship game. You're picked second again this year preseason. JMU is picked first, but they lose the reigning player of the year in the conference, also a two-time defensive player of the year. It has the feeling that the league is a bit wide open this year. Would you agree with that?
Well, I mean, I think until you dethrone the champion, nothing's wide open. I mean, you know, we were the two-time defending champion, and we never felt that it was wide open. So I'm sure James Madison doesn't feel it's wide open. But, you know, they're talented. They're ranked 26th in the country right now. They've got, you know, basically seven of their top nine back. They're the team to beat. There's no doubt about it. And they've got a very good non-conference schedule as well. And, yes, there's going to be a clash between Delaware and JMU, and that's what people talk about a lot. But the whole conference is improved, I think. Drexel's going to be better. You know, Hofstra's got a couple transfers in that are going to make an impact. And, you know, I just think the league up and down is going to be tougher than it was last year. Has anybody gained ground on James Madison? You know, I don't know. That's why you throw the ball up. I mean, we got to see if we've gained any ground. You know, with seven other top nine back and being in, you know, the top, like I said, 26th in the country right now and receiving a lot of votes for even some of the top 25 polls, they're tough to beat. And that's the challenge for our young ladies, though. And but, you know, like I always say, you don't win a championship in preseason. I mean, they obviously picked JMU and they picked us second, but everybody has to prove themselves, and that's exactly what we're going to try to do is prove ourselves.
Well, your program has been proving itself for a long time. Certainly an impressive year a season ago with another 20-win season, another trip to the CAA championship game. We're looking forward to great things this year. Good luck, and thanks so much for your time.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Delaware head coach Tina Martin. That'll do it for this first edition, the season preview of Beyond the Arc. Our thanks to Scott Klatskin and Monté Ross for joining us earlier, and of course, Jimmy Smith and his whole Hens All Access team. I'm Matt Janis. Thanks so much for tuning in. A reminder, the season gets underway for the men on Monday as they travel to visit Liberty. The women will play their first game on Friday on the road. Their home opener is on Sunday against Marist. Thanks so much for tuning in, everybody.